Good morning, everyone. And welcome to church on this third Sunday in Lent. Friends who are worshiping at home, glad to know you are there and you are so warmly welcome to worship with us this morning. What a beautiful, beautiful Sunday morning it is. Sun is up there and weather is warming up, and my goodness sake. Again, if you find your bulletins, please, I'm going to mention just a couple of things about it. There's lots of information, lots of information. I know you will take it home and read it at home and respond accordingly to all the ministry opportunities you see there. I just want to mention that our Lenten lessons are going well and strongly. What a wonderful experience it has been. We have three more Wednesdays to go. On this coming Wednesday, our own Nicholas Cole will be the speaker. You know, Nicholas was here earlier, but he probably went home. Need to go home sometimes. So you want to come and cheer him up. It's going to be a good talk from him. It's going to be about prayer. So this Wednesday, and then we have two more Wednesdays to go after that. So check that out. Also, from this Sunday on, every time, first Sunday of the month, we will have everyday stewardship message. Okay, check it out. It is in your bulletin. In writing, some of you church family members will write us a story about what is stewardship to you and what the Lord has done and how you've been responding and how you believe it's part of your Christian walk and ministry and your membership and you serving the Lord. So at this time, Connie and Joe Brown has written there. Actually, it's the first one. So we keep on having this every first Sunday of the month in our bulletin. It's going to go to a pastor's letter tonight as well. So thank you so much for responding to that as well. What else I have? Well, there's so much more coming. But I'm going to ask Courtney Cole, our children minister, to come over and come up and make a brief announcement about our Love Your Neighbor gears that we are about to have.
Good morning. I'm excited to share that we are going to have Love Your Neighbor gear. It will be available shortly. You will be able to see some of the proofs on our social media page. And we will also have those on the projector in the coming weeks. So there will be a choice of a child's hat, an adult hat, a t-shirt, and a crew neck, so a hoodie without the hood. And we've worked with Surge to get those prices down. They seem very affordable. And then we're hoping that everyone will be able to wear these gear when we are going out in the community and loving on our neighbors, just so that we can promote, who we are and what we're doing. So we'll keep you posted when those are available to order, and we will send that order form out electronically, and we'll have a paper order form. Thank you.
Thank you. As you notice, we have two people making announcements, not just one. Yeah, that's good. That's good. Now, you have seen me wearing that Love Your Neighbor hat. You may have, and you will be seeing it. Actually, Mary bought it for me for Christmas present. So that's why the gear issue came involved. Of course, the Love Your Neighbor thoughts and philosophy was going on there. So I'm hoping that everyone will be wearing that Love Your Neighbor hat before too long, and t-shirt and sweatshirt, you name it. And Courtney is a good person to get it to you. Believe me, she's a go and getter person. I have a note in my hands. Here's what it says. It's been 2 months, and then there's an exclamation mark. Thank you all for your prayers and support. And there's a name under this message. It says Gerald Moss. Can you find him there? We are so happy, Gerald, you are here. God bless you. God bless you. And then Reverend Bob Stoddard had his knee replacement. How many weeks ago? No, three, four. And first time back to church. Thank you so much. God bless you both for being here. All right, let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, we are so thankful that you have blessed us already. And Lord, you are with us today as we worship as we adore your holy name, as we sing together, as we pray together, as we listen to your word and we receive the Holy Communion. Lord, we love you because you first loved us. Help us to hear about you and from you, and help us to hear about your cross today, as that's the topic. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I invite you to please stand as you are able as we sing our opening song, The Lamb of God, how wash me in his precious blood by Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. Thank you. please turn and greet each other with a sign of Christ's peace. Those of you who are worshiping with us at home, we extend the peace of Christ to you and know that he's present there with you as he is here with us. May you be blessed today.
I have some stuff in my bag. Have you guys seen these things before? Have you used these things before? You have? What do we use these things for? Cleaning, that's right. Do you ever help your parents clean? You do?
Sometimes.
So I have a question for you. How do you know when it's time to clean your house? How do you know? Your mom tells you. Yes. Do you know how I know when it's time to clean my house? When it's dirty, yeah. Do you know how I know? Like when I walk across the kitchen floor and my feet stick. Oh. Or maybe when I go to wake Lily up in the morning, and I can't find her because her room is a disaster zone. Or when I am going to get a glass out of the cupboard to have a glass of water, and I open the cupboard, and I notice that there's more dishes in the sink than there are in the cupboard. That's when I know it's really time to clean things up. So today we're going to learn about a time when Jesus did some house cleaning. It was time for the annual Passover celebration. Oh, you're right. This is a different kind of cleaning. You have to listen to the story. Okay. So he went to the temple, and he could not believe what he saw at the temple. The temple's like church, right? You guys remember that? Okay. Yeah. So he went to the temple. He couldn't believe what he saw. People were selling cattle and sheep and doves. So it was probably really loud and really noisy and really stinky. You're right. And then some of the men were even changing money. They had money tables there, and they were changing, giving people change and so that they could pay their temple taxes. And it looked more like a flea market than it did church. Can you imagine? Do you guys know what a flea market is? Yeah. Can you imagine coming to church and it being like a flea market? No, me either. So Jesus was very angry. And he made a whip from rope. And he drove all of the animals out. Drove the cattle and the sheep out. And he was so angry. He turned over all the money tables. He just flipped them right over. And then the ones that were selling the doves, he said, "Get out of here. How dare you turn my father's house into a market?" So Jesus did some serious house cleaning that day, didn't he? He did some church cleaning that day, some temple cleaning. He did. So as we think about Jesus cleansing the temple, we can also be reminded that there is some other cleaning that needs to be done. The Bible tells us that we are the temple of God, and the Spirit of God lives inside of us. So this season of Lent is a very good time for us to think about how our hearts might need cleaning. And we do that by focusing on Jesus. Can we pray? God, help us remember that we are your temple and that your Spirit lives in us. Help us to keep our lives clean and useful for service to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
The reading of Psalms. Today it's Psalms 19 on pages 667. Heaven is declaring God's glory. The sky is proclaiming his handiwork. One day gushes the news to the next, and one night informs another what needs to be known. Of course, there's no speech, no words. Their voices can't be heard, but their sound extends throughout the world. Their words reach the ends of the earth. God has made a tent in heaven for the sun. The sun is like a groom coming out of his honeymoon suite. Like a warrior, it thrills at running its course. It rises in one end of the sky. Its circuit is complete at the other. Nothing escapes the heat. The Lord's instruction is perfect, reviving one's very being. The Lord's laws are faithful, making naive people wise. The Lord's regulations are right, gladdening the heart. The Lord's commands are pure, giving light to the eyes. Honoring the Lord is correct, lasting forever. The Lord's judgments are true. All of these are righteous. They are more desirable than gold, than tons of pure gold. They are sweeter than honey, even dripping off the honeycomb. No doubt about it, your servant is enlightened by them. There is great reward in keeping them. But can anyone know what they've accidentally done wrong? Clear me of any known sin and save your servant from willful sins. Don't let them rule me. Then I'll be completely blameless. I'll be innocent of great wrongdoing. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing to you, Lord, my rock and my redeemer. The Old Testament reading is Exodus 20, verses 1 through 17 on page 90. Then God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You must have no other gods before me. Do not make an idol for yourself, no form whatsoever of anything in the sky above, or on the earth below, or in the waters underneath the earth. Do not bow down to them or worship them, because I, the Lord your God, am a passionate God. I punish children for their parents' sins, even to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me. But I am loyal and gracious to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. Do not use the Lord your God's name as if it were of no significance. The Lord will not forgive anyone who uses his name that way. Remember the Sabbath day and treat it as holy. 6 days you may work and do all your tasks, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. Do not do any work on it, not you, your sons or daughters, your male or female servants, your animals, or the immigrant who is living with you. Because the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and everything that is in them in 6 days, but rested on the seventh day. That is why the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, so that your life will be long on the fertile land that the Lord your God has given you. Do not kill unjustly. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not testify falsely against your neighbor. Do not desire or try to take your neighbor's house. Do not desire or try to take your neighbor's wife, male or female servant, ox, donkey, or anything else that belongs to your neighbor. The New Testament reading is 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 18 to 25 on page 1387. The message of the cross is foolishness to those who are being destroyed, but it is the power of God for those who are being saved. It is written in Scripture, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and I will reject the intelligence of the intelligent. Where are the wise? Where are the legal experts? Where are today's debaters? Hasn't God made the wisdom of the world foolish? In God's wisdom, he determined that the world would not come to know him through its wisdom. Instead, God was pleased to save those who believe through the foolishness of preaching. Jews ask for signs, and Greeks look for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, which is a scandal to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is God's power and God's wisdom. This is because the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. Please stand, if you can, for the gospel reading. John chapter 2, verses 13 to 22, on page 1291. It was nearly time for the Jewish Passover, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. He found in the temple those who were selling cattle, sheep, and doves, as well as those involved in exchanging currency, sitting there. He made a whip from ropes and chased them all out of the temple, including the cattle and the sheep. He scattered the coins and overturned the tables of those who exchanged currency. He said to the dove sellers, get these things out of here. Don't make my father's house a place of business. His disciples remembered that it was written, passion for your house consumes me. Then the Jewish leaders asked him, by what authority are you doing these things? What miraculous signs will you show us? Jesus answered, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I'll raise it up. The Jewish leaders replied, it took 46 years to build this temple, and you're going to raise it in 3 days? But the temple Jesus was talking about was his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered what he had said, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus has spoken. The word of God for the people of God. Sorry about that. Be to God.
What a beautiful song it was. The truth is that the more Jesus, the better, am I right? The more Jesus in the church, the better church. The more Jesus and less you and less me, the better, am I right? Hard to say amen on that, but that's just the way it is. And the story we have to share and to tell. Before we receive the communion as a reminder about God's constant presence in our lives. Reminder what Jesus did for us on the cross. Would like to listen to the Word of God as we have already heard it as a reading. Now, a little bit preaching as well. As I was working on this third Sunday in Lent sermon, and one of the Lenten themes are the cross, obviously, and the more closer we get to Easter, I guess the more we hear about the cross. So I titled my writing, as I got into my writing process, I titled it Understanding the Cross. Understanding the cross, and the further I got with my writing, I thought I really have to change the title. And I did change it into a trying to understand the cross. Now, some of you have been attending church for quite some time, and maybe you get a feel and idea that you understand everything about the cross. There's nothing new you can hear about the cross. No, that is not quite so. I can confess from my side that I don't understand anything, everything about the cross. I understand some, but I don't have the full knowledge about what does it mean that Jesus died on the cross. Why cross? Why the cross? So during Lenten, we try to understand what the cross is and what it means. The Bible says that the cross is revealing. It is revealing. But do we understand, let me call it, do we understand the mystery of the cross? Why the cross? We would have a nice little religion without the cross. Everything just being happy, 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 and joy, 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 and put big smile on your face and have your religion. And that is what many people do. Why do bother us with the cross? There's one basic rule for us to understand about the cross, namely the cross comes first and then the resurrection. That was the way to Jesus and way of Jesus. First the cross and then the resurrection. First the cross and then the blessings out of it. Now, Paul wanted to make sure that his listeners at the church of Corinth understood the meaning of the cross. Now, when Jesus revealed to the Pharisees that you can destroy this temple, I'm going to build it up, I'm going to build it again in 3 days, they didn't understand that he was talking about his cross. Now, many disciples didn't understand either, remember? Then later, they understood what he was saying. But when Peter preached and taught the church at Corinth, he says, listen, friends, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. If that was true 2,000 years ago, so it is true today. We all need to be familiar with the cross. We all need to learn more about the cross. How often we Christians want to skip the cross. It's tough. There's so much sadness to it. There's so much challenges personally to me, we say, about the cross. We want to have blessings without the cross, but it doesn't work out that way. If you have been somebody who has worshiped at home or here in the sanctuary, if you've been trying to have blessings without the cross, I have a news to you. It is not going to work. It will never work. Cross comes first, the cross comes first, and then the blessings. By the way, did you know that nearly half of your neighbors, no matter where you live, nearly half of your neighbors have either no Christian memory or a distant Christian memory, even here in Berea. Back in Louisville, it was 12%. 12%, and this is several years ago, 12%, that was a pretty good study, 12% of Louisvillians were church, attended church and some church on any given Sunday. 12%. And I'm sure that if we are to ask, interview each other, saying that how many Bereans or how many people in Madison County would go to some church Sunday morning, you would say, well, if it is not 100%, it'd be 90%. Friends, that is not the case. I'd say if half of our members of the community population go to church on any given Sunday morning, that would be a high number. I don't think it is that high. I think it will be somewhere 15-20% at the most. The significance of the cross and Christ crucified on the cross have been largely lost to our culture. Not that the cross as a popular symbol is necessarily lost. We see it everywhere, worn or on display. I remember back in Louisville, I used to go to a Christian bookstore on Mondays to see if there is a good reading, and sometimes I stayed there reading and having my time for myself. It was a nice place. There's a reading corner. There's a corner for readers. There's a section. You can pick up any book. You don't have to buy it. You just read it and put it back where you took it. And then beside that, next to that section or area, there was a jewelry store, Christian jewelry store. All kinds of neat and handy little items for you can buy and decorate your home. And then there is jewelry. There is all kinds of Christian jewelry, including crosses. Lots of different crosses. So one Monday I was there, and I all of a sudden I realized there was people buying mad things, and there was a lady walk in, and he wanted to buy a cross. And she started making her plans to buy one, and there's a good selection, and this young man tried to be helpful to her, trying to show all the different options and lots of selection of different kinds of, variety of different kinds of cross, you name it, golden and silver and wooden and you name it, all kinds, more expensive and less expensive of different size. And that dealing went on and on. When she was about to buy one, then she pulled back and said, oh no, wait a minute, I have to do some more thinking here. And this boy tried to do his best to serve. Then finally, this lady has already missed something. Then she came back and she said, by the way, I want to buy that one right there. The boy tried to see what is it she's pointing. I want to buy that one, that cross where that little man is still on it. That is the slowest explanation of the cross I have ever heard in my life. The crucifix, where the little man is still on it. And she was buying it for her granddaughter's graduation, as she explained. To many people, the cross is still something that where the little man was one time on it. The cross is not empty. The cross is empty. But the blessing is with us today. And the cross is not simply an event, after 2,000 years ago. It is a spiritual reality. It is the fact today. We are all included. We are involved. The cross is preaching to us this morning. Jesus' joy of the cross as God's way to redeem humankind has been vindicated by human experience throughout the centuries. The cross reveals our sin. Have you noticed that? When you pause and when you read the Bible and you start focusing your thoughts on the cross, toward the cross, something starts happening in your heart because it reveals your sins. It reveals the tendencies, should I say, the deep-seated conditions within us, in your heart and in my heart. They are not just bad habits, but they cause spiritual death. They cause spiritual death, and so many people don't understand that. It makes the Christian gospel intelligible, incomprehensible. Christian gospel is the power of God. A radical rebellion of ours that is indeed in you and in me, settled deeply in our human hearts and lives, called for the most drastic action of God's sight to meet and overcome it, to send his son to die on the cross for us. But not only does the cross reveal our sin, it reveals God's love toward us. God loves you, and God loves me. God loves us. At the cross, God meets us with love. If you wonder if anybody loved you ever, look at the cross. Remember what happened there, and you get your answer right there. Everybody being loved by God through Jesus. Even you, my friend, somebody there at home wonder if God still loves you. Jesus has said in words that God is love, but it was on the cross of Calvary that these words took fire and burned. No wonder the Gospel of John 3:16 says, God so loved the world. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Anybody out there who believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Now, every generation finds the cross to be its accuser and its means of salvation. So the cross is preaching to us. Secondly, we are learning to find and see God's victory through the cross. God's victory through the cross. There is power in the cross. It is not the sign of God's majesty and power, but an unforgettable reminder of the lengths to which he will go to bring his people home. When you are worshiping this morning here in the beautiful sanctuary in the sunlight, and thank God that you were brought home. When I welcome new members to join the Berea United Methodist Church, the best I can say is that welcome home. Now, I mean that welcome to God, but welcome to this local congregation. That is to be in home. I hope you feel like home. To God be the glory and victory through the cross. We've been brought home. We are home with Christ through the cross. As great and powerful as symbols it can be, the cross was more than a symbol. It was an action. Jesus did something that nobody else can do. He did it on the cross of Calvary. What did he achieve? Well, we can talk about it all day long. He bore the shame of our sins, rebellion, and failures after failures. Not just the one failure it happened to me, but failures after failures, and shame after shame, and rebellion after rebellion. Jesus took all that on the cross and settled it once for all. So in the cross, he made available forgiveness. That is where it took place. redemption, and release. For this reason, we have hope. We have hope. Somebody, if you are about to lose your home, don't do it. You have no reason to lose your hope. Look at the cross. You're being lifted up forever. Just follow Christ and lean to Him. You will be okay. And confidence and assurance. One of my favorite songs is the Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. If you want to sing that at my funeral, go ahead and do that. I would love that. So this divine Jesus Christ, this Lord and Savior, takes away the sins of the world by His union with every sinner like you and me, who by faith receive Him into His heart. Humankind is not deserted. God still ministers to our need. The cross is a victorious, eternal fact and reality. It has been completed. Jesus said, it is finished. Now, you and I, we don't come Sunday morning to try to improve it, trying to fix it up. If you came to church this morning to look better and fix it up a little bit, you can go back next week and pushing hard. You know, I hate to say I have bad news to you. It's not going to work that way. Only way to find peace and salvation in Jesus Christ is to surrender to Him. You hear me? Surrender to Him. Everything you have, good and bad, whatever they are, surrender to Him. And He will take you up. He will lift you up. He will lift you up. And then we can try to understand many things through the cross, including our salvation, your salvation. Through the cross, God has given us His honest concern to save us from all our sins and death. And death. This is not just the one philosophy among many other philosophies. This is the gospel. This is the good news. Always good news. Nothing bad about the gospel. Although the gospel and the cross always reminds us about Jesus' death, the message of the cross is actually the message of life. You hear me? The message of life. Take a look at the cross before you. When you look at it, it's a reminder to you, I am living. I am alive. I live because my Savior lives. It is life through death. Now, that is not an easy concept to understand. This is why I'm saying it is hard to say we understand everything about the cross, because we do not. But we don't go to heaven by understanding everything, but we go to heaven by having faith in Jesus Christ. Am I right? It is finding a new way of life in rejection, the way of self-trust, self-love, and self-assertion. Your salvation and my salvation and my peace and your fulfillment of God's purpose for you and your life begins by accepting Jesus into your heart, who died for you on the cross. You say, Timo, I've been attending Methodist Church for 50 years, you know it all, I'm good. I've been vaccinated and baptized and the whole thing. There's nothing you can add on. By the way, do you believe in Jesus Christ as your Savior? We don't have much resume to present. Only one resume is what Jesus did for us on the cross. And when we get to that pearly gate, there's no free tickets to Methodists or Baptists or Catholics or Christian people, Christian church people. There's only one kind of ticket. That's a ticket of the cross. What Jesus did on the cross. Now there's no resumes for you to say that, well, I was a board member and I was a trustee and I was a lay leader and I was a preacher and I was a this and that, and Jesus said, thank you for doing that, but listen, hey, let me check out. If you have that sign of my blood in your heart, that's the only way to get in. God did it for us and for you in Jesus Christ on the cross. This is why the cross is so important. The Bible says, all things are of God who has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ. All things are of God. Salvation is anything we did. I would like to save everyone in this world. I can't save one person, even myself. One time I tried to save all my children. I realized that, well, they have to go through the same route as me, and they have to go to Jesus and be forgiven. It is what God did for us through the cross of Jesus Christ. I have a cross to show to you. It's a gift from a man that wanted to give it to me. He was a church member of ours in my previous church. It's a neat piece of art, I would say. Now, this man came from afar to the Lord. He had burned his life, and he was, you and I didn't have faith. If you have seen him, didn't have faith. But God loved him, and God had faith. Now, this is a piece of wood that he found from the swamp, okay? And he said, Timo, I wanted to make this for you to remember me. He said, I was the one in the swamp. Actually, I was going through the swamp. I was halfway through the swamp. But Jesus found me, the cross found me, and there was power in the cross to lift me up. Now he found this piece of rotten wood. If you have visited the swamp, you find pieces of wood there, and they are not good. They don't burn, you don't want to, you just leave them be. But this man said, I am going to find wood, and I'm going to make a cross. He did. They were all rotten and wet, and all. He walked on them, and he made me a cross. This is actually United Methodist cross. Am I right? The cross and flame. Well, it's not the most important thing, but he did this for me, and he said, every time, Timo, when you look at this cross, remember that there is power in the cross. Amen. The power in the cross of Jesus Christ. There is power in the cross of Jesus Christ. It's a beautiful, beautiful piece of furniture made by man who was saved, being saved by Jesus Christ, who died for him on the cross. And the cross is empty, and the way to him is open, and everyone is included and welcomed in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please join me in the welcoming to the Lord's table. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who honestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with all your heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant. Pour it out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Jesus Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. This is the body of Jesus Christ, broken for each and every one of you. And this is the blood of Jesus Christ, shed for each and every one of you. Please come, everything is ready.
Thank you.
This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you, and this is the blood of Jesus Christ shed for you. Go in peace. Jesus Christ will go with you. Amen. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. The body of Jesus Christ broken for you. The body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. And this is the blood of Jesus Christ shed for you. Go in peace. Jesus Christ will go with you. Amen. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the blood of Jesus Christ shed for you. Go in peace. Jesus Christ will go with you. Amen. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. The body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you, and this is the blood of Jesus Christ shed for you. Go in peace. Jesus Christ will go with you. Amen. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. Glory to God. Gerald, this is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. Did you receive it? Okay. Brenda, this is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. Okay. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. This is the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. the body of Jesus Christ broken for you. Blood of Jesus Christ shed for you.
Amen. The blood of Jesus Christ shed for you.
If the ushers can come forward at this time for the ministry of giving. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, in Christ's name, we are thankful that we can participate in your kingdom enterprise by the ministry of giving. In Christ's name, amen. Please stand if you can. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise here the creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Please be seated. Thank you. Before we leave this place of worship and we go back to our mission field, we pray. We pray and we pray constantly. How many of you have a prayer concern in your heart, on your heart this morning? Just about everyone. Then when you turn your bulletins over, in the back of your bulletin, there's a long list of dear names. Some of you are your family. Some of them are your friends. Lots of people there. We want to pray, continue praying, for Becky Conley's family, Bill Shone's family, that is our family in Louisville. We continue praying for Rebecca Minto. Rebecca has several health issues. We pray for Edna. And Gerald, we keep on praying for you. Bob, we pray for you, Bob. We pray for our dear friend Susan. We pray for Franklin. We pray for Nora Ruth and Jewel. We pray for Rita and Ray, their grandson and mom. And then we continue praying for several church family members as we pray for this world and all these war zones in this world. And we pray for our community. There's a written concern to pray for Rebecca Minto, and we continue praying for Rebecca. Let's go to the Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, only thing we have is the cross of Jesus Christ, where all our scores were settled. Whether our personal scores and failures and shortcomings, but also all the failures and troubles that we have within our church and families and communities, we bring them all to you, Jesus, with 100% surrendering to you. You are the healer, Lord. You are the main physician. You are the caregiver. Through your grace, you reach out for our hearts and lives, and you bless us as you have blessed this morning. We thank you, Lord, for your power over our weakness, your love and grace beyond who we are, and your constant patience with us as you care for us and you love us. Come, Holy Spirit, come upon this community today. Come as we leave, come with us as we leave this place, and help us, Lord, to walk closer with you and to you. We pray together as disciples pray, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
I invite you to stand as you are able as we sing our closing hymn, Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross. Let us sing.
I pray. I have already prayed.
What do you think about our Acolyte Minister this morning? Friday morning, I prayed with Jean, who was having a testing PET scan done, and I think there's going to be treatments coming. Is it going to be this week? What day is it this week? Friday. So friends who are close to Jean Dean there, if you don't mind, gather around her. Joe, and who is there's Bob, Reverend Bob Schaefer, turn around and go to Jean, lay your hands on her. And we pray one more time. There are more hands and hearts needed. Who is close by there? Okay? We want to pray. Dear Heavenly Father, you are God of love and mercy, and healing come from you, Jesus. We again pray for Jean, for this treatment that she is about to have. May it be successful for the cancer she is dealing with. Thank you, Lord, for the care you are providing through medical professionals. But Lord, we trust in you, the true healing, whether through medicine or your blessing, Lord, as one way or another, come from you. So we pray for Jean, we pray for Norman and for the whole family, and we trust everything about these treatments under your mercy and power and grace. In the name of Jesus, amen. And as you leave this place of worship, please receive the blessing and benediction. My dear friends, the Lord bless you and keep you. And the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And the Lord turn his face toward you and give you his peace. We pray this in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Good to see him back. Good to see both of you. It's good to see both of you.